It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
We are live right now on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, Carl Quilanche for the Sports Hitlers by the fans and for the fans. Coach, how you doing, sir?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
We're hanging in there. Mr. Mike Miller, we've missed you, brother. I hope everything is well. How's everything down there in Texas? You holding it down out there?
Everything is great. Mac, what's up, my brother?
What's good, Mike? How you doing?
Chilling, man. Living and maintaining, living and thriving by God's grace.
You know, we've been keeping you in our thoughts and prayers. I hope everything is well out there. I know it's been a rough couple of weeks, but Mike told us on his Instagram, since he's from New York, that was light work for him. So he already know how to deal with all of that stuff.
New York City, man, especially, and then coming from Michigan too. Listen, after that, so we just used to this.
If you grew up in the projects, you knew a lot about not having heat. I mean, it got a little crazy because it's Texas, but we've struggled. We've been through those struggles before. I think a lot of us.
You know it. Yeah. And then, but when that radiator kick on though. Man, phenomenal, bro. Yeah, everybody know about that Project Radiator, man. When that thing kick on, woo.
Used to dry it. We gonna outdate them. Who used to dry their clothes on there when you ain't have the
okay?
You know what I mean?
Used to
wash their clothes by hand. Yes. And put it on the radiator.
Put it right on there. Yo, that thing will melt your skin. It was so hot.
You guys are crazy. But definitely again, us. We keeping Texas in our prayers. Also, prayers to Tiger Woods. We got to talk briefly what happened to him. It's really unfortunate. But I heard he's awake. He's speaking out of surgery, but prayers to him. And some of the people with him, Dwayne Wade was with him recently, Jada Pickett Smith, and they said, you know, just live life to the fullest because you just never know. And thank God that he's okay.
Listen, we ain't learned nothing from Kobe Bryant last year, man. When I heard the news, it was like, I wasn't even like really shocked anymore. I'm just like, we've seen it now to this extent. Like no one's promised another minute on this earth, man. So you gotta appreciate it. You know what I mean? And you gotta stop lying about being Nets fans like Eddie, you know?
Yo, what's the heat?
Bang, bang. Bang, bang. Bang, bang.
You start I can off take early, something baby. So serious and then make it into
that's how we do. Let's go, man.
Oh, man. Listen, I, as much as I'd love to sit here and laugh, I can't laugh after losing last night to Luka, man. Listen, this team, this Boston Celtics team is giving me heart attacks. And as much as I want to have faith that they'll turn it around, I don't know. You know, like, I don't know what's going on. There are a lot of blame pie you can put around there. You know, people are saying it's Brad Stevens. Danny Ainge took the blame. I was listening to Mike Gorman, who's the head play-by-play for the Celtics, and he blaming Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown and saying that they don't pass the ball enough. He also said the fact that – but he also said –
want to pass the ball to.
He also said the fact that a lot of these players have an incentive in their salaries to make the All-Star team, so they have to put up a certain amount of numbers and make the All-Star team. And he also said, Scalabrine has spoken to a lot of players around the league and that they would rather make the All-Star team than win games and win a championship. So there's a lot of things going around with younger players. I personally don't know what's going on with the Celtics. At this point, I'm kind of like, this is a wash season. I'm not sure. Matt, what are your thoughts here, man?
You know what? I just think sometimes teams have windows. They have opportunities. When other teams aren't that good, other teams haven't figured it out. The Celtics got into a tough situation where their opportunity came while some of their players were still young. Then you had a Kyrie situation where it didn't work out. You add Kemba, he's injured. Horford, over the hill, you get him out of there. You know, Marcus Smart, injuries. You guys are just realizing that you have windows and you may have not taken advantage of the perfect opportunity to get over the hump, and other teams have caught up. And now you're having a subpar season and you just got to – I don't know if you want to say it's a wash, because what we've seen with the Miami Heat do last year in terms of having a hot run in the playoffs, that's what you got to look forward to. You're not winning. You're not going to get first or second place in the East, I don't think. You got to try and get to the playoffs, see if you can get some continuity and play a little bit better once you get into the postseason. I mean, getting into the postseason and having a shot, I think that's what you guys want.
All right. Mike, your team is also in that Eastern Conference mix where it's like –
Hold on, wait, hold on. What? Come on, you're going to stop disrespecting the Knicks, man.
You had your turn. You could have plugged your team in when you made your way. You did it, so.
But Mike, Listen, he asked me about Boston, and he goes, "And Mike, your team is in the mix, like my team ain't in the mix."
You're still doing it.
That's my bad, Mike.
You're still doing it, Mac.
That's my bad.
It's been decades since we've been in the mix.
Okay, so let me restart. So let me get a restart, Mac. Your team is in the mix. Julius Randle, an all-star. How does that feel to have an all-star? I think the last, when was the last time you guys had an all-star? It was Melo, right? Melo, yeah. Yeah, so how do you feel about that?
No, I think it's dope because I don't just want all-stars. Like, we've had Carmelos before. You know, I grew up in the 90s where we had the Patrick Ewings. You know, we had the all-stars. I like to see it from Julius Randle as growing up. Like, I really think he took a leap and grew up, and Tom Thibodeau did a great job with putting that leadership factor in him. And he got the Knicks to sub-500 basketball one or two games out, which is an amazing accomplishment when you consider when everybody signed, they said, "We have no superstars. We have no stars." That's what they said. They made fun of us to sign us Randle. They said, "You have no stars. The Knicks are just a club's DF house team." And now they're kind of relevant in the East. And here's the relevance. You just know every night you got to play hard against the Knicks. It used to be an automatic dub. Like, you were just thinking, I used to see some players in Marquee Nightclub, One Oak. They used to be hanging out with me right before the game. Like, "Yo, we got the Knicks tomorrow. We about to give out here by 30. Now they got to play hard, man.
No, for sure. And I was actually listening to Mike Breen. He was on ESPN Radio today. He said, playing for Tom Thibodeau, the Knicks go into every game believing that they can win. And when you have that mentality, and I think that's a mentality in their locker room right now, is if you have the mentality that every game that you can win, teams need to be aware of that. And that's credit to Tom Thibodeau.
Before Mike goes, I don't want to talk too much about the Knicks because I usually don't. But last night was a perfect example. They had a great lead. Usually when a team gives up the lead like that to Steph Curry, even regardless of who else is playing, you go 20-8 or 20-7 in the third quarter. That's a 20-point win for the Golden State Warriors. They've taken your confidence. You have no chance of coming back. They usually do the coming back. The way the Knicks fought and got that to a 3-point, 4-point game with about a minute and 30 left showed me that, yeah, this is a team that's just fighting hard. And they hang their hat on the defensive end rather than the offensive end. And, you know, as a New Yorker, that's what we – 90s New York fans, this is what we grew up on. Like, just grit and stars. You know, Allen Houston, Larry Johnson, Latrell Sprewell, they weren't superstars. They were just, you know, stars, and they figured it out for a little while. So I'm proud of what we're doing right now.
So as I was saying before, Mike, your Pacers are in the mix as well. Tied with the Knicks. So the Pacers are 15 and 14. Right now in fourth. What are your thoughts here with the Pacers in that Eastern Conference? Like, it's not Philly or Brooklyn, but it's that mid-pack of teams.
Man, this has been such a weird season because, like, my team shot out the gate, boom, like 4-0. And it was like, all right, we here, like, we're going to make some noise. And then it just a bunch of injuries happened. Trades happen, and so we haven't been able to get all our pieces back. We made one mistake when we went on like a 4-5 game skid where we tried to insert, because Jeremy Lamb had came back and Doug McDermott was playing great in the starting lineup, and we just tried to and Nate Bjorken just tried to force Jeremy Lamb into it, and he was messing up the chemistry. And once they made that switch, then we started to get back together a little bit.
Mike, are you making excuses? Oh, you hearing excuses from you?
We're talking about reasons. See, we're talking about reasons. You got to, when you watch the game.
I'm kidding.
So I saw it and I was like, okay. And Nate made the adjustment. He saw after the, which I like. I like he's doing a great job of making those in-game adjustments now. But just overall, it seems like those middle of the road teams, you could get 2, 3, maybe 4 wins, but then you would probably lose 2 in a row. So it just seems like this is just
definitely, Mike.
Yeah, right. But you know what? The NBA just released their second half schedule, and according
don't to
Prime,
don't think they ain't rigged that. Don't think they ain't rigged that. Listen, I've never heard of nothing like that.
Listen, they said
to release a second half schedule.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
Rough. Yeah, five games. But you know what? But they're saying a lot of teams are gonna have to play 5 games in 7 nights. Some of the superstars are gonna have to rest.
I guarantee you, the Knicks have a solid schedule because they gained some type of relevance. And they want to see if the Knicks can be decent. I guarantee
you. After this, you know it's true, Mac. And yeah. I never heard of that, where you wait till the middle of the season to say, you know what, let's see. You know they were sitting there saying, let's
okay, see. Here's the reasoning let's behind get the it. Listen, here's the excuse behind it. There were a lot of postponed games because of COVID, so they had to reschedule those games in the second half. So that's the reason why they had to release the schedule again. That. Are you buying or selling that?
I ain't trying to hit out it. Oh, okay. No, I bet the Lakers got a weak schedule. I bet you the Lakers got a weak schedule.
You know why, Carl? Because if I'm seeing the NCAA, well, maybe the NCAA didn't do a great job of it, so let me retract that. But I'm seeing other leagues where if it got postponed, they just left about 2 or 3 weeks of availability to have a makeup date for certain games. Like when you just, like you can still say what teams you're playing, and then you got to make up those days, you know, that you don't put the schedule of when you're playing them. They could have had the teams that you have to play each time and then put that out and said, we don't know when we're going to get some of these games made, so we're going to leave the dates open because you may have to play four in a row. But now when you get to go and start to predict, like the biggest thing someone told me last year about the bubble, and this goes to the point, is they said a lot of teams did well because one of the toughest things in the NBA that people don't talk about is travel.
Travel, yeah. So
they said travel, and this is an NBA player. He said travel, and when you got to finish a game in New York, get right on a flight, fly to Golden State, get off that flight at 3 a.m., go to the hotel, wake up at 10 for breakfast, shoot around at 2 or 3, and then you got to play the game at 7, you're dead. Your legs are dead. You look up at the clock and you're down 30-6. So the bubble eliminated that. So I think they could have did it a little bit better, but it's going to be a little shaky.
But you know what though, Mac, I think a lot of the players are missing that because nowadays, even they're traveling, they're not getting a chance to even go out. They can't go anywhere. They go to the hotel, like they can't socialize after the games. Ooh. So in a sense, some of the players are missing the old format from last year as opposed to this year.
I mean, I guess so. I guess you could. I mean, personally, for personal life, you're missing the nightlife and the getting to go out and get to have dinner. But professionally, for your bodies, it's helping a lot of players with their bodies and having to, you know, be able to rest their bodies from last year when they were in a bubble. And even this year a little bit because, like, some of them aren't going out as much. Some teams aren't practicing as hard because they know what it's a
situation. Some teams are barely getting any practice at all. Some of them are playing
extra games. That because remember, just a couple of years ago, they had stopped doing they decreased the back to backs. They eliminated the 3 and 4 nights. So you're going to see this start to catch up to people in mid March and into the playoffs. Some people what you're going to see is because they're doing 5 games and 7 nights, people are going to start taking games off. You know that's what's going to happen, especially the veteran teams, veteran players. Like everybody's been talking about LeBron, should he take time off? Anthony Davis is going to be gone for a month. You're going to start to see Kawhi Leonard and them are used to. You're going to start to see players saying, oh, it's 5 and 7 nights. Okay, well, if on one of these nights I'm playing like a Sacramento or something where they're tough, but they're not a playoff team, I'm not playing that night, because especially because I got the Clippers the next night. So you're going to start to see that. All that strategic, like, resting, that's going to start to happen more. So
So before we
hold on. Talk about. Carl, looked at the schedule, man. Listen, I just looked at the schedule, and I saw, like, 3 Nick NBA games on TV. Like, this is what I'm talking about. The Knicks were not on TV. I think we had 1 game on TV when the first schedule came out.
Now we got four.
This is what I'm talking about, man.
Before we start talking about the MVP talk, I wanted to talk about the All-Star. I know Mike is a little upset that Baby Sabonis got snubbed. Devin Booker's clearly the snub. Well, Mac, any thoughts on the snubs, or are you satisfied with the All-Star teams, or do you not care for it this year?
No, I'm never satisfied. I mean, it's always going to be snubs. You get what I'm saying? But Sabonis, I thought, like, Sabonis Vujicic, I always say his name wrong, from Orlando. Pronounce the name. I think I pronounced it right. But Vujicic and Randle, I believe, were, like, the last three all fighting for the same one of the last spots. That's what I thought. And I thought Sabonis, if you would have told me Sabonis would have made it, I would have said he deserved it as well. When your team is in fourth place, fifth place, and you trade a Victor Oladipo away, you trade a player like that away, and you still keep pace, no pun intended to the paces, you still keep pace, you deserve to get to the All-Star game. And so I'm hoping, they said Kevin Durant, I don't think is returning until after All-Star break. He don't need to play in the All-Star game. Give that spot up. We already know who you are. Give that spot up. Let Sabonis get right there and take that spot. That fixes that situation. The other situation, Anthony Davis, you don't need to be playing in the All-Star game.
He's not going to play.
Yeah. D. Booker, take that spot. But I think for D. Booker, more than Sabonis, this is personal. Those coaches left his name out. You voted. I know what you tried to do is basically say, without CP3, you trash. That's what they said.
That's what he said. That's what they said.
But you know what? But that's what's been the narrative. But you know what, Coach? That's been the narrative. And the Hitler's group has been the narrative because last week when we talked about CP3, we looked at the teams that he went to before him and when he got there, how well they've been doing. For example, Phoenix right now. Phoenix is, I believe, 10 games over 500. OKC last year, without CP3, they were not in the playoff mix and they got CP3. So it's safe to say Chris Paul did get them there. That's a fair
statement. I could also say this. No. Remember my statement, and I think you liked the comment because you said it did make sense. The players who are there are still playing with Chris Paul also. So it's not like he went to Phoenix and you traded Devin Booker away and Chris Paul without Devin Booker got Phoenix to 10 games above 500. It's like you sent him to the Houston Rockets and James Harden went to another team and Chris Paul elevated the Rockets without James Harden. With the Oklahoma City team is the only team I'll give you where they didn't have superstars, but they still had the same nucleus of players, of good players around them. So, I mean, if we're just talking D. Book, he deserved to be on that team. I'm sorry.
Absolutely, he deserved it.
Yo, listen. Hey, man, you know how I feel. I text and told
you. You know why I think you texted me? Because I think one of my players took Sabonis' spot. Because we're playing subpar and terrible, and we have two All-Stars. And meanwhile,
I'm not even mad at your guy. Vucevic doesn't belong there. Their team is trash. Orlando is trash. Sabonis got the same numbers as him. He's averaging a career high in points, a career high in rebounds, a career high in assists, and we're the fourth seed. They're 13-19 and got clapped by Detroit last night. Vucevic don't belong. They got clapped. So no, that's grimy. Like he should have been there, but he's not. Him not making it is the same reason when we talk about MVP why somebody's not naming in it. It's because people just don't care about the Pacers like that. That's what it comes down to.
But they can't. But listen, Orlando and is Orlando a better market? Is what we're saying.
Disney World. What you talking about?
Yeah, I guess. But no one's been caring about Orlando. Okay.
The Disney World. What are you talking about?
Okay. All right. Okay.
And with D Book, I agree with Mac in that people got to stop confusing. If I'm on a team and I'm good, because I was one of the people that was early on. Remember, I said, I was like, Devin Booker, stop it, win me some games. But then I changed my mind. I was like, nah, he's nice. People got to stop conflating things or confusing things. If I'm already a good player and another good player comes to play with me, that doesn't automatically mean he's the reason we're better. It's like Max said, no, we're together now. So one good player with another good player makes us better. But that doesn't mean you're the reason. And when Devin Booker was dealing with COVID protocols, they lost like six in a row. They won towards when he was coming back. So if we look at it, Devin Booker's the best player. Of course, Chris Paul makes them better, but it's what Max said. That's personal. They're saying without Chris Paul, y'all are trash, and you're a looter in a riot, and you just get numbers and no one cares. That's personal. So no, of course he got snubbed. That's right.
All right, we have Jordan Eugene joining us. Jordan, how you doing, sir?
No Rockets on the All-Star team.
What are your thoughts on the All-Star reserves? Are there any snubs? What are your thoughts there with the snubs?
Obviously, Devin Booker. I also believe that Damian Lillard should start. But other than that, I don't think that too many people didn't really get snubbed per se. I was actually really happy besides what they did with Devin Booker, 100,000%. Because, I mean, Devin Booker, like, I understand that Phoenix was never really – like, Phoenix wasn't this good until Chris Paul came and then essentially changed Phoenix's present. However, Devin Booker is obviously, I mean, a baller, so –
Mike, we have Greg Polia. Shout out to him in the comments. He said – Vujicic is statistically having a better year than Sabonis, and we have to stop using team records to determine if they're all-star.
Vujicic is averaging one better point. They're averaging the same amount of rebounds. They both averaging the same amount of assists. Shut up. Shut up. I was waiting for that. I was waiting for that. Shut up. I was waiting for that.
Well, there we go.
I was waiting for that. Shut up. Shut up. I was waiting for them. And we're better than them. And we're better than them. Stop it.
Oh, man. Okay, so let's discuss what I wanted to talk about was the MVP. We're at the almost midway point. Five MVP candidates. But we really know how the NBA gives this award. It all determines on record, with the exception of that one year that Russell Westbrook had that average triple-double, I believe his team with six. They tend to go with the one seed or the two seed. But the MVP candidates, safe to say, Steph, LeBron, Joel Embiid, Lillard, and Jokic. Jordan, let me start with you. What are your thoughts with the MVP race? Who do you have in the lead?
I have a bad history with MVP awards. Obviously, with James Harden, I feel getting snubbed all those years. I mean, to be honest with you, it's possible that you could talk about James Harden in that race, even though he does play with two superstars. However,
that's just you being biased. We know this.
Maybe a little. Maybe a little.
To be honest and say it, then Jordan, say it with your chest. You biased. You could be biased.
I'm a little biased. I think that James Harden should be in the conversation. I don't think he should win it. I think that the award has turned into best player on the best team, and therefore, right now, Joel Embiid would have to be my MVP right now, if the season were to end today. But thank God the season does not end today.
Okay, Coach, what are your thoughts here with the early MVP race and the potential candidates?
I mean, we narrowed down. I mean, I think most of us got the same top five. You got Joel Embiid, LeBron James, Steph Curry, Joker.
And
Joker's up there. Dame Lillard, he's up there. Then you got your next guys like James Harden, who's around there. But like Eugene said, because of who he plays with, you know, it's going to be a little difficult for him. So I'm not mad at that list, and I hate people who are killing like Joel Embiid, like, oh, what have you done in the playoffs? Listen, I'm gonna say this the last time. This is regular season. The playoffs doesn't exist for this vote. It doesn't exist. Imagine an NBA where when the NBA regular season ended, the season ended. That's what the MVP vote means. Once the regular season finishes, that's it. It's a new season for the playoffs with a new MVP. If Philly continues to play the same way they're playing, Ben Simmons has been injured. Joel Embiid has literally put the team on his back. He's carried the team. If they continue to play at the pace they're playing and end the season either first or second in the entire NBA, I'll give a nod to Joel Embiid. LeBron James, if you want to claim that last MVP, that last hope, now is the time when you got to prove it. People call me LeBron haters, but that shot he took to tie the game up two games ago, I think that when they were playing against the Washington Wizards, that three-point shot was just like he's tired. Like physically, he's tired. He's playing a lot of minutes. And I think he's going to burn out if he doesn't really focus in on what's important to him. So LeBron got to make a decision. Do you want to try and get a last MVP or another MVP and play all these 38 minutes, 40 minutes per game? Or do you want to just make the playoffs and win the championship? Whichever way he thinks, we'll see how that race turns out. Curry, I don't see them finishing past fifth or sixth, you know what I mean? So I don't think he gets in the MVP race. Lillard, the same thing. I don't think he's going to win enough games. And then you got Joker. So
a lot of what you like to call the LeBronians say that it's a shame that he hasn't won an MVP since 2013, and that he's due for one. It's been a while since he had
Come
one.
Come on,
so.
What is this?
Listen, if you're going to make that argument that he's the best player in the world every single year and he doesn't have it, you can make that argument. I'm just saying that's what they make the argument for. But Mike, what are your thoughts here with the MVP race? Do you have those top five? Is there anybody else that kind of deserves to be up there, or are we okay with the list?
First of all, to be direct, Vucevic, we're going to do it real quick. They're averaging two more points. Damo's averaging more rebounds and more assists. So put some respect on my man's name, please. Thank you. Now, I hate the MVP voting right now. I hate it because I'm going to just come out and tell Donovan Mitchell's the MVP right now.
I was waiting for somebody to say that. Yeah, because they're number one.
Carl, let's break it down. He's the MVP. Let's look at the past 6 years of the NBA MVP. It has went to the best player on the number one team. Only 1 year it didn't happen. That was Russell Westbrook when he did something that hasn't been done in 58 years. Donovan Mitchell is averaging 25, 6, and 5 on the best team clearly in the league. They're on pace to win 65 games. He's the MVP, and it's crazy that his name doesn't even get mentioned. That's because he plays in Utah.
25, 5, and 4.
If he has those numbers on the Knicks and they're 26 and 5, he's the MVP, front runner. It's only because he plays in Utah. This is disrespectful. If you look at their numbers, Utah, he should be the leading MVP vote getter. Because you look at Steph's MVP in 2015. It was 23, 8, and 4. He clearly won MVP. You look at Derrick Rose's MVP in 2010. It was 25, 8, and 3. He clearly won MVP. Why is Donovan Mitchell's name not even being mentioned? That's disrespectful, yo. He should be the MVP, clearly. He's not going to win because the narratives are driving everything. LeBron had a narrative coming in, oh, he's old. So anything he does, we overrated. Joel Embiid, he had a narrative. He's underachieving. So when he does something at his potential, then we go crazy, even though they be losing to Toronto and they be getting smacked by bad teams. But we go overrated. KD only played, he missed half the games. Kawhi Leonard be missing games, and they're not the best record. James Harden just got there. Like, we just throwing it. Steph, like Max said, their record's not going to be high enough. We just throwing every name, and there's a dude whose team is about to be on pace to win 65 games. He's the MVP.
Mike, hold on.
I do have to say one thing, though.
One second, Coach. I got a message from Mike from Mrs. Kulan. She said, save your energy for tomorrow's show. Did she say it for you?
I got more than that.
Go ahead, Coach. Coach, go ahead, sir.
No, I was going to say, I think people, when you dive into the numbers, offensively, yes, you know, Donovan Mitchell is putting up a very, very good offensive numbers, you know, efficient team leader. But here's the thing. When you watch the way the Jazz win, it's on defense. So, you know, that's why I think they're, and it might not be fair, Mike. It might be a narrative, Mike, like you said, because when you look at the Jazz, you're like seeing a collective, even though he's averaging 25. And maybe that's the media put that in our minds, not to see Donovan Mitchell as just a destroyer. And we're looking at the Jazz as the sum of all its parts, rather than when we look at Philly, the narrative have expressed out that this is Joel Embiid's team. If they win, it's because of Joel Embiid. If it's the Lakers, if they win, it's because of LeBron James. If it's the Warriors, it's definitely got to be Curry. Well, when we hear the Jazz, they don't always say it's because of Donovan Mitchell. They say Rudy Gerber, Defensive Player of the Year. You know, you got shooters. Mike Conley is a very good player. It's their system. So the media, I kind of agree with you. The media is determining which narratives to put out there to make us subconsciously put other players ahead of each other.
Well, is it safe to say, do you remember the year the Hawks won were the number one record? I believe they won 60 games one year, right, the Hawks? And I don't think they had an MVP candidate that year.
I'm so glad you brought that up, Carl.
So I gave you an alley-oop. I gave you an alley.
Yes, you did. And I will slam dunk it. When the Hawks won 61 games, when they led the league and won 61 games, their leading scorer was Paul Millsap. He was averaging 16. Donovan Mitchell is the clear best player. And when you watch, like Max said, I think media narratives, and most people don't watch Utah Jazz. Let's be real. Most people don't watch them. But when you watch those games, you will see that there are moments where their defense fails them and they need offensive output. And Donovan Mitchell will do a 7-0 run, like when they played the Clippers or when they played the Hornets the other night. It was a back and forth game. It'll be a 7-0 run, and then Donovan Mitchell will bring them back, and then everybody starts hitting shots. And Mike Conley was missing time. That's their point guard. Remember, 2 years ago, that was Donovan Mitchell's problem, was when Ricky Rubio went down, he had to be the point guard, and he didn't know how to develop those skills. But when Mike Conley went down earlier, Donovan Mitchell picked up the point guard skills, passing more, assisting. He is literally their best player. And fourth quarter, he takes over. Every fourth quarter, even against the Clippers, they didn't win it. It was a close game. But fourth quarter, he took over because they were getting clapped. So I just think it's between fans not watching the Utah Jazz because they're not on TV as much. And the media, like Max said, they've already picked their seven people over this
LeBronians.
Dude.
Eugene. I want to let Eugene go before I go into my LeBron.
Yeah, so what do you think? Jordan, you didn't have Donovan Mitchell in your top for the candidate. You actually put in James Harden, who's not even listed. What are your thoughts about what Mike had to say about Donovan Mitchell? Do you think he's deserving?
Mike had points because if you're really following the NBA's narrative, then absolutely, like that's what they've done forever. They didn't really care much about market or not. It was just, you know, Giannis for the past 2 years, and then, you know, you have James Harden who was MVP and Russell Westbrook and so on and so forth. So it's like they followed this narrative until, I mean, before, like, you know, Russell Westbrook won it because he was averaging a triple-double. But then James Harden won it when, you know, the Rockets were the best team in the league and eventually lost to the Warriors in the third round. And then Giannis won it back-to-back because he was the best player on the best team. You know, so I do agree with Mike. Mike does have some points. So you do tend to forget sometimes about the Utah Jazz. So I'll give Mike his points. Yeah, Donovan Mitchell.
That's purposely done by, I feel, the media and LeBronian Nation. LeBronian Nation, they not slick. I know what they do. I know what they do.
He's talking to you, Dave. I see you in the comments, Dave. They're talking to you.
They kind of bring other candidates, like they attacked for 2 years. Their campaign was strictly on Giannis. They formulated Transformers. They came together and said, we're going to discredit Giannis because of what he doesn't do in the postseason, even though this was a regular season MVP. So they tried that campaign. It didn't work. Now they're going to the first line you hear from LeBronians. I swear to you. I mean, when you do this at 36, like, how can
you
not?
You go.
Verbatim. Nobody cares, bro.
Coach, like, verbatim.
That's how it goes. It's time, bro. It's time. We don't do that with nobody else, bro.
When Jay-Z was putting out heat later on in his career, we didn't say, yo, when you 40 and you throw, nah, it's how you, what's your lyrics about? LeBron, you gotta show me, LeBron, 36 or not this year without Davis, you guys gotta win games. I'm seeing, you guys gotta win games.
Bottom line.
If you keep your numbers up, man, and you end up over, like, here's the thing. Why should you be the MVP over Donovan Mitchell if his team finishes ahead of yours? And his numbers are exactly where they are. Why is LeBron the MVP of the league if Donovan is playing with the same kind of talent, y'all want to tell me? Because it's not like he got superstars over there. Mike Conley's he's a role player kind of now. He's later on in his career. Yeah. Goldberg's defensively, they got pieces, just like the Lakers have pieces. And he doesn't even have a second superstar in AD. He's doing it with just a defensive superstar. So if he finishes and wins the West, if the Jazz win the West, there's no way LeBron James can be the MVP. It's impossible for me. Mike, you won me over. I wasn't thinking that before, but now that you won me over on this.
My man.
You won me over on this.
But just listening to the LeBronians and we see them in the comments, is there a year LeBron was number one and he didn't win it? And he
I don't care.
When he won his two MVPs in Cleveland, they were number one both years. What are y'all talking about?
No, that is the way. No, I'm saying over the last 7 years, he had. Was 2017, were they number one in the East?
No. Remember, the Warriors were number one in the league. But 2017 was Russell Westbrook's year. He averaged a triple-double. Yeah, okay. It hadn't been done in 58 years. Okay. The next year, James Harden won. They were the number one seed. Then the next 2 years, Giannis won. They were the number one seed. The 2 years before that, Steph won. They were the number one seed every year. Come on,
This is what they do, Carl. When he won it those 2 years in Miami, they said he deserved to win it because Miami was number one. That, remember, when he won it in Miami, they said, how can you not give it to LeBron? The team is the best team in the league. Now when you got other teams, it's the best team in the league with MVP candidates, when you're 56 years old and you're doing your average 13,
we don't know that Utah's ever going to have a run like this again.
Last year he did take it personal for not getting votes, so that
if we keeping it real, outside of LeBronians making narratives, there was no argument for him over Giannis last year. They was on pace to win 70 games. Giannis was averaging 30. There was no argument to make, but the narrative was, as Max said, but yo, when you mad old, you can do. No, that's not the narrative. Every year it's been clear. When he was on Cleveland, they were the best team in the league. 66 wins, 62 wins. He won MVP. Come on, Donovan Mitchell.
Record last year.
Okay, but Mike, but let me say this. Like, you made the argument for Donovan Mitchell, but with Joel Embiid, we've seen him. This is the best we've seen him play.
That's what I'm saying. That was that second narrative, Carl. Right. Joel Embiid's narrative going in every year is he underachieves. He'll come in unconditioned and he underachieves. So now when he plays to his potential, that makes him the MVP. No, we still gotta evaluate him in the context of everything else going on. When is Utah? Who projected Utah would be 25-6? No one. Come on,
yeah,
bro.
Nobody.
It's the same thing with Steph in 2015. Same scenario. It's one star in a book. Nobody knew who Draymond and Klay. Nobody knew who they were. They're playing with Stephen Curry. Nobody expected them to win 67 games. They did. He was the MVP. Donovan Mitchell's doing the same thing. Utah's doing the same thing. He's the MVP. Like, come on, bro. This is crazy. These narratives are ridiculous now. We don't know when the next time Donovan Mitchell is going to have a team like this.
This is the Oscars. A lot of PR and media teams are in the background controlling the narratives to make sure that their client gets put to the front. This is like the Oscars, man. We got some drama. I can't wait to see how it plays out.
Wait, so there's no way that we could possibly start a campaign or a way to push Donovan Mitchell up in that MVP ladder? Because, again, we're getting players like Stephen Lillard, whose teams are clearly not in the number one seed. But Donovan Mitchell's team
needs people to talk for him. Like, seriously, it's not going to get done by tonight.
They got a primetime game tonight against the Lakers. They got to blow them out tonight. He got to get 40. Now, they're going to make an excuse anyway and say, well, they don't have AD. They don't have Dennis Schroeder. So that's why Utah can't just win tonight. They need to blow out the Lakers by 40. They got to beat them by 40.
And he got to have to say, at the end of the game, he needs to say, I'm the best player in the NBA right now. My team is the
and
best.
He's humble.
He
got to do it, though.
You got to say that. He got to come out and be like, you know what, guys? We trying to put a point to Utah. We here. We got one of the best records. We playing hard. You know, I should be mentioned with the best players in the NBA right now. You say something like that, the media is going to react to it. They're going
to
talk.
Wait, Donovan Mitchell, you need to be looking at this.
I got a question.
What's up,
dude? I got a question. How many MVPs, like how many people win MVP and then they have a teammate that also wins another award? Like defensive player of the year, six man.
Steph Curry. It happened to Allen Iverson that 2001 season.
Okay.
How often?
I understand it happens, but how often nowadays does it really happen?
Draymond and Steph, right?
Okay, that's one. Anybody else in the last decade?
Giannis got both awards.
If it wasn't for Giannis,
Anthony Davis would have got it if it wasn't Giannis.
You
know?
Giannis got both awards that last year.
It happens.
So it happens. It does happen.
It happens. It's not impossible. But defense is
what really happens. Like with the narrative now, because the narrative has changed. The narrative has completely changed from when it was when Allen Iverson was playing, when Steph won it all the way back then, because Steph obviously was the clear MVP. It wasn't between two guys, and it was just about it wasn't just necessarily record at that point. You know,
yeah, what? That's why. Look at his numbers in 2015. That's why everybody was complaining that James Harden should have won it that year.
Who was better than? Oh, Harden. Well,
that's why everybody was because he was 24. He only was averaging 23-8-4, and everybody was complaining and saying, "But James Harden's averaging 30." But the Warriors were 67-15.
Who else was James Harden playing with?
Nothing you can argue. Like,
who else was James Harden playing with?
Come on, this is what we're going to do to discredit.
We're going to too many layers now.
That would have made James Harden's argument better because they would have said, well, Steph is playing with Klay and they would have said, James Harden's not playing with those caliber players.
But you just said that they didn't know who Klay and Draymond were.
That's the point. Steph on a team as one star with a bunch of good players around him. Their team got – Draymond was a good defender, but their team, because of their success, he was the MVP. It is the identical situation with Donovan Mitchell. It's the identical situation. Same thing.
But, again, overall, though, we know it. With the exception of Russ, with that special year, every time the MVP, it's always the number one seed. Like, it's never changed. Like, it's been
clockwork. It's clockwork.
In history, and look it up. I think the last time it happened –
I mean, that's to assume like that Utah's going to do that. Like, that's to assume Utah's
going to
be.
Why are we going to assume they're not going to? You see how the media got you already going against them?
Like, I don't think Utah's legit.
Guys, let me tell you something. Jordan is a journalism major at Stony Brook, so he knows how to weave his way out and
create his own
narratives.
He's one of my guys.
So we have a special guest joining us. He's here to put in a MVP candidate.
Yes.
What do you have?
Come on, this is a serious peace conversation.
Peace and salutations to the world.
Come on, man, you're going to have him derailing the conversation. I'm going to get him to derail the conversation.
Listen. How can y'all forget LaMelo Ball?
Yo, I'm out. Yo, Carl, you cannot allow it.
How can he not be in the All-Star game right now?
Because he's not an All-Star.
And it's no way he was going to make it. And it's no way.
He's not an All-Star.
It's no way.
He should be in the MVP conversation.
What?
Do you see what he did to Jordan's team?
Yo, Ant, stop playing, man. This is a serious
conversation. Do you see what he did to Jordan's team?
Yo, Ant, he playing good. What? Stop it, man. Stop. You got to stop it.
How am I stop what?
Okay,
LaMelo, he would have been in a rookie game if they would have had it.
He would have been in a rookie game.
The skills challenge. We'd have had him in the skills challenge.
Anthony, no, he should be in the All-Star game. Listen, he should have been a reserve at the least.
Anthony, I let you in to be serious. Do you have a serious MVP candidate? Be real.
Of course I do. Seriously, MVP, it should go. Of course you know me. I'm not going with you have to be on the best team and all of that different kind of stuff. So I actually feel it should go to Joel Embiid. Embiid is doing the most. He's pulling along Ben Simmons, and his team is at what? They're at the top of the East. Right. Oh yeah, for now. So I say give it to Embiid based on what he was doing.
That was my initial work. Listen, I'm cool with Embiid, or if they continue with the same records and they close one game off, two games off, I'm cool with a hearted debate between Donovan Mitchell and Joel Embiid. I can if they stay where they're at, I can see that being a great debate.
I don't see why everybody got Mitchell up there, really.
Why shouldn't he be?
Bro, I mean, you ain't hear what I just said? 30. Let me break it down for you. Yeah, let me break it down for you. You hear what I said? He 25-5-4. His team is 25-6. They on pace to win 65 games, bro. Why not? Why? It consistently, the league shows us best player, best team. You breaking records, MVP.
If you ask me, your man probably doing a little better than him.
Who? Steph? No, Steph individually.
Not Steph on the Pacers.
Oh, Damo's doing.
Hold on, if he's doing more than him, that means Julius Randle doing more than both of them. So what are we talking about?
Hold on, Julius Randle averaging like one more point. No, stop. Cut it out.
Okay, so he should be in the conversation.
Like one more point than Damo.
Listen, we might as well throw in my guys in the conversation.
Let's not derail it with the silliness. See what you did, Ed? This is what you did.
Sorry.
You made it silly. Like, come on, man.
All right, guys, before I let you go, let me try to change the topic real quick. You know, I always have a bonus topic. We may not want to talk about it.
Hold on. Manny, chill out with Kyrie. That's my man, but don't throw him in his MVP talk right now.
So, calm down. So, let me bring this up real quick. Meek Mill and his Kobe comment and his I had to talk about it. This is what's trending.
I didn't know he said anything, but he said.
He said, I'm going out with my chopper. It'll be another Kobe in one of his lyrics in a song, he said. So
I know what he meant to say.
But hold on. So Vanessa Bryant took it to Instagram and she tagged him and she said, I find the line to be extremely insensitive and disrespectful, period. I'm not familiar with any of your music, but I believe you can do better than this. If you're a fan, fine. There's a better way to show your admiration for my husband.
That's cat,
nice respect and tact. But again, I've seen fans say this. They said, we can't pick and choose because Lil Wayne had a Emmett Till line and you know, people weren't cancel culture for him, but we're doing it for Kobe, so we can't pick and choose.
Yeah, Rick Ross had a rape line one time.
Right. Is it fair or foul for his lines against Kobe? Is it too soon? How do we interpret this, Coach? Let me start.
Ask the Laker fan. Ask him. Ask the Laker. Well, Mac a Kobe fan too. So
yeah, I'm a big Kobe. Listen, I saw it both ways because I know what he meant. Like, for, you know, people, I'm not like on a Ray Jarvis, you know, his podcast with the rap, but I do know a lot of rap.
Rap round, shout out to the rap round table. Yeah.
Shout out to the rap. They really break it down. But for me, it's like what he meant was Kobe was a legend. He went down in a chopper as a legend. So what he was trying to say was, if I'm going to go down, I'm going to go down with a chopper because I'm a legend. Just like Kobe. He wasn't I don't think he was trying to say, I want, but he just said it. You can't say it. It's a time and a place. That's not the line that you have to put Kobe's name in. And that's when right. Everyone is just coming from it. If you're going to say something positive, like, you know, I got 2 fours and I'm shooting, you know, I'm shooting outside like I'm Kobe. Like if you said something like that, but when you say chopper and he died in a chopper, and that's not the way you
the
say
it. The bar was trash. Like, first of all, let's just start there. Let's just start that the bar was trash.
Super trash.
Okay, it didn't make sense. That's the first thing I thought. Yeah. Like, it didn't make sense. First of all, let's get into it. Like, if you get caught lacking, that means you don't have anything. So how you can you go out?
Right.
So no, how he can said, you go but out what he said, with your chopper if you're what lacking?
What was that?
Hold on. Let me ring it back. He said this bitch I'm effing always tell me that she show love, but she ain't never show me. Yeah, if I'm ever like I'm going out like with my chopper, it'll be
that'll make
another
sense. That'll make sense. Well, so, if you lacking, you ain't got the chopper.
No, because he's saying lacking meaning you caught the chopper's on you, but you was caught slipping. You wasn't aware of your surroundings and they caught you lacking, they firing on you. And that's what I know what
maybe,
he's trying to say.
Maybe. All right. Let's just save him that way.
So Mike, as the former rapper in here and the MC, break it down for us.
I understand the bar. He's using a double entendre. I understand the bar, but as everybody's saying, it's poor choice. It's not right now, bro. Just not right.
Actually,
Not ever. No, I would not use that. That's not a bar you use, bro. Just don't mention Kobe and Chopper, bro. Like you trying to be clever.
Imagine a bachata singer or a salsa singer saying we going down in the flames like Roberto Clemente, like because he died in a plane crash. Like that would not rock. You get what I'm saying? Imagine
that's a perfect example. Like you get come on, bro. You don't do that.
You don't, especially like almost.
But you know what to me? But you know what was alarming to me? Like these rappers and celebrities, they have PR and professional people who you know are in their team. Don't you proofread something? Doesn't somebody
He went to the studio late at night. He thought the line was fire. He got the beef with Tekashi, so he had a little. Everybody's talking about him, and he leaked the snippet, thinking that people were going to jump to him like, "Oh yeah, Meek, that's what he's talking about." And she hit him with the, "I'm not familiar with your music. I think you can do better."
She treated him like a B rapper. She treated him like an indie rapper.
Because Kobe is from Philly. She had to hear.
She knows who Meek is.
And even if you didn't know him, the first thing you do is you go Google Meek Mills, and you're going to see like maybe 2 or 3 songs that you heard.
Maybe she knows Meek, but not the music. You know,
But I think, I don't think Meek did it that way. I think he did it for what it was, for the shock value, which is why they wanted to put it out. The shock value, they know people was going to talk about it, good or bad. We all know all press is good press. So regardless of anything,
are we about that cancel culture for Meek, or are we going to forgive him?
It
is what it is.
Make a better line, bro. Come on, man. Like, come on. Now's not the time for that.
Yeah, he apologized.
Time for that.
He apologized in private. You know, he said he reached out in private. And if Vanessa's accepting an apology, then that's what it is. You know, cancel culture is when it usually takes a little while for people to catch you and you still don't apologize and you think you're trying to be sneaky about it. And then we got to get you up out of there because you've been fraudulent. He was in the heat of the moment, said a whack line. Vanessa got him, and now he apologized, and he said, you know what? I did wrong, and the only way we can move on from this is if we move on to something else. So,
Jordan, what are your thoughts here with this before we wrap up?
Meek Mill's always been a clown, man. He's always been funny. He's always been a little bit silly. Like, there's music. Now, some of his rap songs, I mean, obviously, they have some, like, history to them. But, you know, Dreams and Nightmares. But, like, I mean, Meek, like, it was just poor timing. It was poor use of words. You don't use Kobe and Chopper in the same sentence. Everything that they said has been touched upon. I've already thought it. But, yeah, I agree everything with what Mike and Ant and Mac had to say.
All right. Anthony, I see your background. And so you think you're funny. You're not funny.
Look, I started
that's why
that.
You're on mute. Call, yeah, I see your background. It's not funny. You think you're funny. There with
look,
that.
He taking it personal, too. And look at him getting mad. Carl getting mad about that. Yo, stop violating him, man.
That's why he's muted. Here, that's why he came, you're muted.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You do.
And he dug down so we could. I didn't see it. I didn't know what he was doing.
I know exactly what he was doing. Anthony, any final thoughts? I know you wanted to talk quickly about the fantasy. Did you want to mention the hitless fantasy because everyone's going crazy with the fantasy, or are you good?
Yo, can y'all just let the trades go through? Like, what kind of league y'all got where people just be crying about
Mac, are you in the trades? Are you in the league too?
NBA is too crazy for me because I'll do football, but NBA is like every night. You got a lot of lineups. It's a lot for me, man. I can't do that.
All right. Coach, any final thoughts before we close out the show? Final thoughts here before we wrap up.
Nah, I think we got some good topics, man. I think if you really listen to the content, you know, we touched on a lot of different things. I think we heard some different opinions. You know, like I wasn't really on board with Donovan Mitchell, but Mike made a good case. And I think that's what this show is about, like letting people, you know, get their opinions off and seeing if some of it sticks to the viewers and listeners. But, you know, big shout out to Eddie, man. You know, he's still riding. the guy tagged me and like, yo, listen.
I saw that. I did see that. He did do that.
He posted about the Nets. He posted about the Nets after they got Kyrie and tried to use the five posts about
someone tag Eddie in this so he can see it later on.
He posted about the Nets tag Eddie 15 times in the last 2.5 years. And he posted about LeBron maybe 4,000 times in the last 2 months.
Right. Yeah, but you know what? Today he admitted that Patrick Ewing was his favorite player too. So I'm
He's bugged.
I'm a little nervous.
Yo, listen, he's a salsa dancer. I see him.
Yeah,
which he knows how to dance.
That's how you know he makes bad decisions.
He's nice for the show.
He's dancing around our questions. He's dancing around our question.
Yo, he loved Mike, though. Mike, I'll never forget the first time you were on the Zoom with him. It's like Mike's biggest fan, yo. He was ready to get your autograph, yo.
Mike, you better sign that screenshot he took. You've been acting on Hollywood since you moved and all of that, you know? Stop being like that.
Yo, hold on, Mike. He wants you to tell him who's the list of sucker MCs.
I cannot reveal that list yet. I told him that.
Mike, any final thoughts, brother? Any final thoughts before we wrap up?
This is the last week. Y'all see the fist. This is the last week of Black History Month. But, yo, listen, man, we make Black History all year round, 365, baby. So we just going to continue to celebrate and support and uplift our people, man. ADOS, we here. Black History Month, baby. Oh, I love this sports hit list, man. I appreciate all of you guys. For your prayers and everything, man. We good
sure,
here.
Man. Absolutely. Yo, be careful of those deers when you're taking your jump shots. I'll be seeing them, man. They be lurking.
Yo, listen, they be threatening me, man. They be threatening me, man. I'm taking it personally, man.
Jordan, final thoughts here before we close out.
Joel Embiid for MVP.
All right, there you go. There it is. Please make sure you check out the Sports Hitless content. Mike Miller will be on the B Show tomorrow at 5:30. Please make sure you tune into that. Him and Deb will have a conversation. The B Show, 5 o'clock on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Special shout out to Faco. He has his show on Mondays and Fridays. Declan, the Smokes podcast. I keep forgetting the name of their podcast, but it's coming out.
Yo, hold on.
Smoke and Mirrors podcast on Mondays and Fridays. What's up?
We need Falco back on here, man. See, after the election, he ain't been back with us.
No. That's not true.
Not only do they take your passport after you storm the Capitol, but they take away your internet rights.
Listen, that's not true.
They take away your internet rights.
Listen, that's not true. Listen, he was on that episode when we were talking about standing for the flag.
I'm joking.
And Mike was ready to go in that
episode. That's why he came on that episode. But I mean, hold on, Marcus Lamar. Where Marcus Lamar been?
Yo, we haven't seen him since the election. We haven't seen him since the election.
Marcus Lamar. What did I just tell you? Why did I get suspended for storming the Capitol?
Listen, get him back. We want him back, man. I like those guys.
Come back,
I don't know because a lot of hit list people don't want them in the streets. I don't know.
Nah, we need them. What you mean?
Nah, we love that guy.
We need different.
Love that guy.
Listen, I'm gonna be honest. You have your own opinion politically, socially. We all entitled to that. But those two guys, they got passion for the sports.
Hold on, you guys got 5 minutes. Let me see if I can get Falco to make a case for LeBron.
Yeah, bring Falco in, man.
Yeah, he's always gonna take a chance to talk LeBron, so I know he's gonna pull up.
We're not silencing people. We want them on the show.
Come right on in here and be fans and love the
He's coming. Here we go. He's coming in.
Catch all these jokes. Right.
Come in here. Tell him come in here, man, right now.
He said to give him 2 to 3 minutes. In the conversation about – but, Anthony, let me ask you this. Why haven't you made a case for LeBron for the MVP? I mean, he is 36.
He know better. He know better.
Nah.
Why not?
I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to be a homer. You know, I'm not just going to be biased or anything like that.
I'm proud of you.
Thank you. And you know why I'm proud of you, too? Because we mentioned Steph Curry, and you didn't disqualify it. You okay with it?
No. I'm glad. You want to know why?
Why?
Because y'all saying Steph is okay just makes my point of why Anthony Davis was okay to say when I said he was in my MVP conversation years ago he was in the same situation
putting up
great numbers on a team who was either in the eighth or fighting to be in it. And his team ended up being in the eighth seed.
Is not the point. It wasn't no who was either. They was not in the playoffs when we had that discussion.
So
it's different from Steph this year. They're in the playoffs.
I don't mean just because they're AC, don't mean they're going to make it. It's the play-ins this year. They may get bumped out.
We asking about right now. We're not talking about if.
They're not in the playoffs right now. Again, they're in the play-in games. They're in the play-in games. They're not in the playoffs.
Speaking of Anthony Davis.
Right. He liked that. He's like that.
Is he?
Great. And he's like that.
Did he look like that this year? Has he been looking that way?
Yeah.
My man Falco.
He's coming. Yeah. He's coming. Oh, my God.
Billy Hoyle. Let's go.
Mike, let me give you some backstory. So Falco posted a picture of him doing a two-handed dunk to Walmart and said, get on my level or something like that because he wants to challenge Mac to a game. That's what he wants to do. He wants to play Mac.
Mac, you going
to
play him or what, man?
Yo, listen. The streets, I was going to play him straight up. The street said he got to go through Israel first. It's like boxing.
Israel's the champ right now.
You know he's not coming out here.
So wait, Anthony, didn't you play Israel and beat him?
Nah, he beat me.
Oh, he beat you.
Yeah.
Israel the champ. Hold on. Glenn play. What's the name? They got to play first?
We don't talk about Miss Cleo no more. Miss Cleo's been expelled.
Hold on, call.
Oh, he's been expelled?
Yeah, because of what he did. Remember what he did last time?
Yeah, get him out of here.
Here we go, Carl. This is what we're going to do. We're going to have the hit. This is like, you ever saw Enter the Dragon? You know what I mean? This is like the hit list basketball challenge.
Yeah, it's a hierarchy.
We're going to have the challenge.
Mac is the final level, okay?
You see my back? That's the final level. That was your dunk last week. White man can jump. We gave you some credit. I'm giving you some credit.
Hold on. If I get criticized till I dunk, let's see you dunk.
I don't dunk.
No. All right, so then you can't criticize me. You can't criticize me about dunking.
I didn't criticize you dunking. You saw my comment. I said that the reach step was slow. I'm going to get a swipe on a steal on that. I never said nothing about your hops. I never criticized.
But you can't criticize anything about the dunk if you can't dunk.
No, I criticized the play. The step through was slow.
Did I dunk?
Yo, poking on Instagram, Brandon. I want to see it.
Falco, you were asked to be in here. The guys miss you. They wanted to hear your opinion on this MVP.
MVP talk, baby.
I want to touch on this. You know what I was thinking? Why not Kyrie Irving? Hold on, listen to me. Kyrie's giving you over 27.5, over 5.5 assists a game. What he is doing, not only is he giving you 27.5 a game, on 52% field goal percentage, 40% from three-point range, 90% from the free throw line, not only that, with that efficiency, he takes tougher shots than any other guy in the NBA and still that efficient. Why not Kyrie? I think his playmaking and his court vision has taken an entirely new step forward. What Kyrie has been doing, this is the best basketball I've ever seen him play. I think he's clearly and sensationally the most
over Donovan player. Mitchell. He's over Donovan Mitchell. He's had a better season than Donovan Mitchell.
Yes, yes. Kyrie.
No.
But what Kyrie?
And that's my man. That's my guy. But no.
Dude, what Kyrie not does? What Kyrie does with a basketball in his hand is special.
No.
Okay, he's
6'2".
But again,
soaking wet.
But Falco, keep in mind though, he's playing with Kevin Durant,
James Harden, Kevin Durant.
How do you elect him MVP when you're playing with two other top?
And you're the third option.
And you're number three.
You're the third option.
Away what Kyrie's doing.
But he's the third option, Brandon. There's two other dudes better than him.
He's not even the best player on his team. He's not even the best player on his team.
That's the point. He's not the best player on the
team. Listen, Kevin Durant had a game where he was shooting 83% from the field. He was like 11 of 13. Come on.
He's not the best player on his team, Brandon. Like, how can you make that argument?
I understand that. It's how great individually Kyrie has been.
Brandon, he's been great. But I think it's harder to do that when you don't have anybody as great with you. Because teams definitely zero in on you more. When you take that break and go to the bench, your team can be down 15 in a second because nobody can pick up the slack. You get less rest, tougher shots. When you go into the lane, three jerseys are on you because you're not kicking it out to guys who are caliber of Kevin Durant, James Harden, and even with Joe Harris. Like, I think that you got to put that into effect. I'm not going to take it away from him, but you got to put that into effect.
All right, but yeah, Durant, Irving, and Harden have played 7 games together as a trio. We got to take that to account, number one.
He's
and
still playing with one of them.
Kyrie is pushing with three defenders on him. He beats the guy off the dribble. There's two guys waiting for him at the rim. He still finishes through them. He's having a 40-50-90 season, taking tougher shots than anybody in the league. Like, that can't be ignored. And his court vision playmaking has the best I've ever seen from him.
So no case for LeBron.
Yo, Manny, hold on. What is Manny talking about?
The past, LeBron was the MVP 1 week ago. He's losing that. Like, the past week has killed him. Like,
why was LeBron the MVP? Can you tell me the reasoning? No, I'm not saying he's not. A week ago, I just want to see what was the reason and why he was MVP.
He's putting up the same MVP caliber numbers he does every single year. And again, this isn't my – this is not the way I approach it, but this is the way the MVP works and narratives. I don't make up the narratives. But yeah, he has narratives going for him, which is a way to win MVP. The year 18, age 36. Playing every single game, man.
We messed with you, Brandon, because we were just talking about LeBron fans, and I say, yo, in the first 2 minutes, they're going to hit you with he's 36 years old, man. Like,
it's a narrative on his side. The MVP is all about narratives. And again,
Do you agree with that narrative?
Yeah, we agree.
I don't agree with that narrative. But you know what is amazing, though? This is where it's just like LeBron's, again, age 36, year 18. He's still the most reliable player in the league. That's undebatable. He's the most reliable player in the league this late in his career when other guys can't even sniff coming close to 18 years in this league.
I don't know, Brandon. It's a tough stretch for him. Like, yeah, seriously. Like if he shows me – like, I just told the other panelists, if in this stretch he can play above 500 basketball without Anthony Davis, then to me, he gets back in there.
I don't know. Yeah, I just say maybe Kyrie's not the MVP – but I think he should be a top 5 candidate. I think it's fair to put Kyrie at number 4 behind Embiid.
The snub will come when Kyrie doesn't make all NBA first team. Remember, you heard it here first. He will not make all NBA first team.
He's not going to make it because James is going to get in at that point guard spot. He's not going to make it.
You're going to have James, Steph. That's two right there, right? No,
that's two. He can't make it. It's impossible. Because then you got James, Luka. It's impossible for him to make it.
What Brandon's saying though, if Kyrie's numbers are better than Steph Curry's, I know he has less work.
Hold on, exactly.
No, his numbers are better.
Steph may get in.
And depending on Steph averaging 30 and 8.
Kyrie's giving you 25-5.
Better shooting numbers. That's what I meant to say. Better 40, shooting 50, numbers.
90, taking tougher shots than anybody in the league.
You're making a key point.
If they keep winning and they end up number one and not Philly, then
if they win, that's what I'm saying. If they finish first place, you're gonna tell me if Steph finishes sixth or seventh, and their so numbers give it, are 3 points different, whoa, you're going to give first.
Here's the question. Hold on.
On that, wait. We can't talk about the numbers and say, oh, well, Steph's numbers may be better than his, and then also hold against Kyrie that he's playing with better guys. Facts. Steph's numbers are going to be inflated because his team is worse. But
well, you can look at that a different
numbers.
But you can look at that differently and say, because you have three great players, then Kyrie doesn't have to get doubled. It's easier for him to score than Steph. Steph gets doubled and triple teamed
together. They played seven games together.
No, James is still on the court. There's nobody like James Harden on the Warriors. So Steph is not going to get – Steph right. doesn't have the advantage of that. Where Kyrie right. can, at points, play one-on-one basketball. Steph don't ever have that advantage.
No, Kyrie is not –
So basically Kyrie's right now, for all team, first team, it's a three-man race right now. It's Steph, Kyrie, and James.
No, my point is James too.
Yeah.
You got it. That's what I'm saying. Are they going to give it to – is James and Kyrie going to make the All-NBA first team? They're going to take somebody from the West. If not Donovan Mitchell, Damian Lillard, they're going to take somebody.
Kyrie should. That's my pick. Dude, what he does with the basketball in hand, he's a magician.
It's going to be a good debate. They can't make it.
Jordan, hop into this debate real quick. All-NBA first team. What are your thoughts here?
Kyrie goes second. Second. All-NBA second team. James Harden makes all NBA first team.
So James and Steph. So James and Steph.
No bias on that one. No bias on that one.
That's okay.
No bias on that.
That's okay, Jordan. That's okay. So you have James.
So Kyrie gives you
James and Steph.
James and Steph.
Look,
Brandon.
Okay. Come on. All NBA, you got to have only two guards?
You don't even know. Yeah, it's positions.
Yeah, two guards, three forwards. Yeah.
Lillard.
That's what I'm saying. Damian Lillard is going to.
We're disrespecting Damian Lillard way too much.
You know what? Time out. Here we go. Greg Polius, our favorite guy, he says Trae Young is having a better year than Kyrie Irving.
Get out of here. Get Trae Young. All right,
come on, Greg. He already fucked up. Yo, Greg, good night. Turn your computer off. Turn your internet off.
Right. Pitches and catches reported, bro.
They did. Listen, this is what he's saying. This is what Greg is saying. That's what he said. I'm just reading the comments.
Carl, stop reading his comments.
I have to. This is my job.
If there are dumb comments, don't read them. It's that simple, man. Don't read them, man. Come on, Greg, stop it. You my man,
What place are the Hawks in? Respect.
Bro, they're like in 11th place right now. They've been losing.
You can't talk.
Come on, man. Stop. No, you can't do that. Greg, you my man. I love you, but stop, bro. Cut it out.
In terms of just individual, regardless of who's around you, Kyrie Irving's had the best season of any point guard.
No, he hasn't. Wait, say that one more time. Say that again.
From as an individual perspective, ignoring who's around you, Kyrie Irving has had the best season of any
point. You can't ignore
him. He's having the best season or has it had? Wait, time out. Wait.
Had? Yes.
That you've ever seen?
No. This season.
Over anybody? Over Dame?
Over Steph?
Yes. How is it better than Steph?
Steph has been great. All right, it's not saying one guy's great, the other guys are not. Steph has been great, but he's also had those games where he did go missing and goes ice cold.
Kyrie literally went missing. Huh? He literally went missing. He left.
You're done after that. Yeah, he did. That's it. Great point. That's it, Falco. You're done after that. That's it. Are we not going to include that, though? That should be included in the discussion when you're talking about All-NBA.
He did
miss those games.
He left. He wasn't playing. He did.
I forgot about that. I'm not going to lie.
Come on, man. We can't do that.
That was a good one. I forgot about that. You got it.
But the Trae Young is not an argument, though. We're not going to put Trae Young.
Come on, Carl.
I'm asking a question. Come on, let me ask the question.
Greg, you my man, but you're bugging out. We should throw Luka. We should throw Luka in there too, right?
Right. Come on, so stop. Come out, man. Let's put in Jeff Teague too, since we just gonna put people in.
Nah, let's not. I think that does it for the conversation. Guys, thank you for joining me here on the Sports Hitlers by the fans and for the fans. Make sure you check out the Falco Takeaway. I think your show is on Tuesdays and Fridays, right?
Brandon bought some fire too. I told you.
Yeah, you know what? I'm proud of him. He didn't say LeBron, man.
Yeah, I'm proud of him too, man.
I'm proud of him, yo. He didn't talk about the cap for LeBron.
He didn't jump on LeBron. Good job.
If you asked me a week ago, I would have said LeBron, but like this week.
You know what it is? I think they're getting a little nervous going into the
final. Matter of fact, can I shout out the number one LeBron fan? It's changed. It's somebody else.
Who?
And the sports hit list, comment if you agree with me. It used to be Brandon. Then it was Marcus. Then it was Eddie. But the biggest LeBron fan by far is Eric. You know why?
Yeah, Eric.
You know
why?
Eric is low because he writes so much stuff. You don't understand. It all comes back to LeBron.
You know what? I wish Eric was here because he has a lot to say about Allen Iverson. He does. He can't stand.
Nah, Eric. Yo, we got to get him on. But start watching Eric. See this. The last segment call. We're gonna start doing shout outs to tell people to look out for what people do. Shout out to Eric. Start watching how everything comes back to LeBron and how great LeBron is. I'm not kidding you. Go search. Yeah. It could be a post about football, and he'll sneak LeBron in there on the low in like paragraph number 7. So big shout out to Eric. You're the biggest LeBron.
Falco, let me ask you this question before I let you go. Are you concerned about the Lakers' throne with the Nets?
Absolutely. The Nets are the best team in basketball. The Nets are the best team, 100%. Mm. I'm at the point where I feel like the Nets are close in terms of firepower, a little bit less than the Durant Warriors. I'm serious. Like they have, there's no team in the NBA, even a healthy Lakers team, that could sustain four quarters going bucket for bucket with that Nets team. They have too many options. There's too much firepower. You could see teams maybe go bucket to bucket for a half, maybe even three quarters, but they're not doing it for 48 minutes and four quarters.
That's, I agree, man.
Everybody else. They're the best team in the league.
I think it's the best.
James Harden has been in his bag.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, coach. What was your final point?
No, I was going to say, I think it may be the best bucket for bucket team ever.
Don't make that fake.
You know I'm going to challenge it.
Ooh.
Go ahead.
From the Warriors run. You know, the best backcourt ever, you know, the Splash Brothers. This team is better than that team. Again,
I think he's
making a distinction of bucket to bucket. Wait, I know what he's saying.
Bucket for bucket. Watch this.
Bucket for bucket.
Listen. Bucket for bucket. You talking about the team without Durant on the Warriors?
The team with Durant.
But even before Durant.
But even the 73 and 9 team was incredible.
Right, and that's me. With Durant or without Durant?
Durant and Durant balance block each other out. So Durant and Durant, they block each other out.
Fine.
James Harden and Steph Curry block each other out. Them two people get put up the same kind of scoring numbers, and James actually passes it at a better rate.
So the tiebreaker is Klay and
Klay Thompson and Kyrie.
And I'm going to get you here, but Klay Thompson's the guy. What did he score, like 37 in the quarter or something like that?
But you got to go average.
You're going
to average. That's what I'm saying. But Matt, what he's talking about is when they playing in a game, Klay can do that.
Yes, right? That's what I'm saying. Yeah, it's what I'm saying. Don't sleep on those Warriors. Listen.
You know what Kyrie can do that Klay can't do? You could give Kyrie the ball at the top of the key, clear it out, and he can get you any bucket any way you want it. Jump shot, finish in the lane, dipsy do, skip to my loop. Whatever you need, it's a close one. Now here comes the tiebreaker. Iguodala shooting from the wing, Joe Harris shooting from the wing. I think the Nets bucket for bucket, bucket for bucket, not a better team. Bucket for bucket may have one, if not the best, they're right there, the best all time bucket Nets for buckets.
How is that Nets team going to guard that Warrior team? How?
No one's guarding nobody. No one's guarding nobody.
Klay going to play defense. Draymond going to play defense.
Who guarded Kyrie the year? The only fresh season Kyrie was healthy when they went to the championship. 16. He was feasting on the Warriors. Feasting.
2017, he went off.
He was feasting.
Yeah, he was. Yeah.
All.
And they weren't guarding him.
Nobody can guard him.
That's fair.
So now you add James Harden?
Okay, Jordan, final thoughts on that debate, though. Nets team versus one of the Warriors.
It's a push, man. It's a push. I don't know.
I thought. See, Mike didn't answer the question.
Wait. We're talking Durant Warriors, or we're talking 73?
Durant Warriors. Durant Warriors.
I was about to say 73-9 is getting washed out the water, but I mean, even the Durant Warriors, I still see the Nets because you know you got James Harden on your team, you got Kyrie.
But again, they still haven't won a championship yet, and that team won.
No, we just
they got to
go on buckets.
We just talking about buckets. Yo, I ain't gonna lie, Carl. If we was just like, we going to the park and it's it's that Warriors team with Draymond. Let's say it's the death lineup, and it's the Nets finishing lineup with probably Jeff Green and Joe Harris.
Hold on, Carl. I gotta address the guy in the comments.
Hold on. We gotta get Mike to answer the question. Mike, come on, man. Answer the question.
Man, if it's the Warriors death lineup, I'm picking the Warriors death lineup.
I told you, man.
It's Draymond. Because it's Draymond. Draymond's gonna make the difference.
I'm going with the Nets all day. I'm sorry. You guys are underrated. Clay is 37 and a quarter. Yes, thank you. You see what I'm saying?
14-3.
How do we ignore that?
Young had 50 before.
He ain't never had 37 in the quarter. Stop that, man.
Bucket for bucket, the Warriors could be more explosive.
I think they could score more quicker.
Maybe the Nets bucket for bucket, but
I don't even know about that.
The Warriors could be way more explosive than the Nets ever could. That's the biggest
thing. Listen, the Nets percentage that they're chasing in terms of greatest offense of all time, you know who has that. The Warriors, the 17 Warriors have that record. They chased in their record. So right. We already know this Warriors team, but you talk about buckets? Like, I'm going with the Warriors. I ain't going to lie. I'm going with the Warriors.
How do you ignore the 30-something in the quarter, though?
I don't ignore the 30-something in the quarter, because what I'm trying to say is, like, that's one game. Like, James Harden has done, not 37 in a quarter, but he's had some 50 points in a row. So, like, we can't just go one or two games. I'm talking about, like, career-wise, if you, like, had an 82-game season, who's the most explosive offense? When healthy, or you have to get a bucket, I think the Warriors, what the Nets have is three guys who can each not only create their own shot, but are elite good shooters as well. They're double trouble. Kevin Durant can take you off the dribble. James Harden can ISO you. Kyrie Irving can ISO you. Klay Thompson is a system three-point shooter. He didn't have to take any of dribbles in that 37 points. He took 5 dribbles total in the game. He had 60 points. That is scary. But which means that if you take him off that team and put him somewhere else.
Let's not talk about that.
We're saying on that team.
Don't do that, Mac. You know we can't do that. Mac, we can't do that. That's an unknown. That's an unknown.
We don't know.
Who's averaging? Are the Warriors averaging more combined points as a triplet? Klay, Steph, and Durant. Then Durant's average, James Harden average, and Kyrie's average. Let's look at that.
The only reason why I would push that is the league now is different than the league 4 and 5 years ago. Offenses are exploding, Mac. We know that. People are scoring 139 every night. It's a different type of offense, but in terms of, remember, the percentage, they're trying to chase the Warriors' percentage. That the Warriors have the greatest offense ever. They're trying to chase that. Brother, that offense, Mac, he's going to stand it. Klay gets to play with Steph, and all they're going to do is keep moving. See, the ISO ball was cute. Houston tried it against this Warriors team. Yeah. All that movement, it makes it a little difficult when you got to chase Klay and Steph.
We're not talking about who's going to win the game. I'm just talking about what Brandon was saying was just straight buckets.
It's a tough one, Carl. Don't understate it.
Klay is not a better scorer than Kyrie, though.
What did he do in Chicago? Did he break the 3-point record?
What was that?
Yes, he has 14 threes in a game.
14 threes in the game.
In one game.
The Warriors could be more explosive.
I don't know.
Come on, man.
Kyrie could do more. It's like, I'll put it to you this way. It's like LeBron versus Melo. Melo can do more moves. LeBron's a better scorer. Melo could just do more things. But LeBron's the better scorer. So Kyrie may do more moves.
I know.
I just wanted to give you, Matt, give a shout out to Kyan. Isn't he going to Christ the King, right?
Kyan, my boy, Al. A lot of people don't know. Mike, you guys know a former St. Francis alum, Al Shep, was his coach for AAU. Yeah.
Oh, Al Shep was his coach?
Yeah, Al Shep coached
him. That's my guy. Al Shepard. Shout out to Al Shepard.
AAU. So big shout out to him. Big shout out to Kyan. He's going to get good coaching by Joe over there. Christ the King. They're going to do a good job. Before we get out, you know what I got to do, Carl.
Go ahead, man.
Just hold on. Now, keep going. It's coming for my man.
For who? Who's it going for? Eddie?
You know, there's only one person I got to talk to right now. I see him in the, I've seen him. Somebody alerted to me to some of his comments.
Oh, man. He said, let's go Nets. Mac is working on something special right now. I know he's got something.
I got something for Eddie.
I'm curious to know what.
It used to be for other people, but this is for Eddie.
Remember the time? That's what it is.
All right, Eddie. Remember
listen.
The
no,
time.
Eddie's in listen. Here. Eddie,
you gotta do the dance because I know the dance. It's like do it.
Like, you know what I mean?
I'm sorry, but Jordan's too young for that. Jordan is too young.
They don't know about that.
Jordan's too young.
They don't know about that.
Brandon's too young. They don't know about that yet.
They don't know about the dance.
Let me say this for
rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Let me say this for Eddie. He asked, first of all, when you're synonymous with your team, you don't have to post every day about them. I'm synonymous with the Knicks. I've been to more Knicks games than you have socks. Literally, if you go in your drawer right now and you take out every sock you own, that will not even put a dent in the amount of. I was at the game last night, first 2,000 fans. I don't post about it because everybody knows I'm a Knicks fan from the ground up. Kobe was my favorite player in the world. I never posted about Kobe more than I talked about my Knicks. What do you think it started from when they said, did the Knicks play? You know why? Because when this group first started, I made a comment after every single Knicks game. Now, when we play good and we play every single Knicks game, I'm synonymous with the Knicks. So when you get that kind of credibility, you don't have to post about your team every day. I've graduated to elder statesman where I move the conversation around. Now. I talk about different topics because I don't have to talk about the Knicks all the time. They know I'm the source when it comes to the Knicks with the rest of the Knicks fans. We got, hold on, who's the new guy? We got new Knicks fans. What's the young guy name? That posts after every Knicks game now.
Sean.
I gotta let the guys grow. I can't take his thunder. Sean is coming up in the game. Let him talk about the Knicks and get all the comments. Because I'm gonna let the young generation grow. But you, my friend, you took 2 years and you posted more about LeBron than you posted about Jesus. You know what I mean? You took 2 years where you posted more about LeBron than I ever heard you say anything about the Nets. Brandon, you're a LeBron fan, Brandon. Am I saying the truth or am I lying?
No, I'm
every sure. five, every one Nets post, you had 10 LeBron that's posts. Bad. Another one. And it was another one. And that's where the meme comes from. So you just got to continue to get this work. You can become a Nets fan. I'm not saying this is forever. I'm just saying for right now, we're not allowing you to enjoy the fruits of the Nets' labor. Because it's a lot of fans who've been with them, really. Manny has grinded. We killed Manny when they were horrible. We killed them when they drafted all their trades to Boston. And Boston revamped their team and got better. Where were you, buddy? Where were you? So do you remember the time? No, we don't remember the time.
No, I'm out, y'all.
Being a Nets fan, bro.
Yo, hold on, love y'all, man. This is fun. Yo, I'm out, y'all.
Do you on the phone, on the street?
Hold on. I got something for him. I'm trying
I know Eddie coming up. In. Bring Eddie in here, man.
Nah. Oh, man.
This episode got a lot of special guests today, man. We going.
Can you guys hear it? I got it for you, Mac. Mac, can you hear it?
Nah, we can't hear it. We got to hey. What
you
want to check?
Can you hear it now? Let me see.
Do you remember? Hey. We fell in love. Oh, pause it.
Go ahead.
This Eddie, we going this song for you, Eddie. Cause we gotta remember. Do you remember when you was a LeBron fan? You never talked about the Nets then. Do you remember? All them posts about LeBron.
Oh, man. You guys take care. You guys, thanks for joining us on the Sports Analyst. We're having some fun. Eddie, we love you, man. We love you, brother. We'll talk to you guys soon.
Real talk. I love Ed, man. He's a good sport. Love you, Ed, man.
I'll talk to you guys soon. Take care. Have a good night.